G'day everybody, nice to see you. Welcome to our final call of the Standard Chartered Singapore Marathon Training Talk Series. My name is Ben and I'm the head coach at Coach, a company that helps people just like you optimize track and enjoy their training. Now, there's just a few weeks till race day and most of the work should be done. There's not a whole lot more you can do from a fitness point of view to improve your performance. So the purpose of this call is to help you maximize your fitness and express it on race day with the best result possible. The title of the call is called How to Run Like Eliud Kipchoge. Very few of us, probably no one on this call, is ever going to run anywhere near as quick as that fella. He's incredibly fast. He's the best we've ever seen. And we can't really compete with his genetics. But we can compete with the way that he races and with the self-control that he displays in his execution on race day. And that's what this call is about. Get the most from your race, all right?
Can I get an original skinny dip?
I'm joined today by my friend, an athlete I coach called Riana. I'm going to be bringing her in a little while. She has stuffed up a whole bunch of marathons. She's made lots of mistakes. She's had some poor results. But to her credit, she has learned to race like Eliud Kipchoge. And her last few races have been pretty impressive. And since she's relatable, she's a 4-hour plus marathon runner, nothing too fancy. I thought she was a great person to come on the call and speak with you. Originally, I was thinking of speaking with someone like Suri Yong, who's Singapore's fastest marathon runner. He's fantastic at execution as well. It's one of the things I'm most impressed about by his racing. But again, him and us, there's probably quite a lot of performance difference. And so I wanted to try and make this as relatable as possible for you. Before we get into the call though, I'm going to put up a poll. I would like you guys to give me some quick feedback about your plans for the race. I've just launched that. So please just give me your answers there. That'll help me determine where we're at as a group. The challenge of doing these types of calls with 100 over people is that I don't know who you are. And that makes keeping things personal quite challenging because we're speaking to a broad range of people. And before we get into the main call, I'm just going to quickly remind you of the race dates and flag off times. 5 and 10K are happening on Saturday the 3rd. Bright and early, 6:30 a.m. for the 10K, 8:30 a.m. start for the 5K. The half marathon and marathon are on Sunday, 4th of December at the sprightly time of 4:30 a.m. The kids dash, where I will be running with my twins, is on Friday evening, 2nd of December at 7 p.m. You guys will want to check out the runner info guide available for download from the Singapore Marathon website. If you haven't looked at that now, that is something within your control and is incredibly important so that you know what to do on race day. Check that out after this call. And if you haven't entered, what the heck's keeping you? You should have entered by now. But the good news is if you do want to run and you're a late mover, the entries are open until 25th of November. So do get your entry in. If you have any questions as we go through this call, please feel free to post them in the chat. Depending on time, we may not be able to answer all of them if we're flooded with questions, but I will do my best to get answers out to you either through social media or in a form of a blog post or something post-call if we can't address all the questions that come in. We have some prizes that we're going to be giving away after the call. Stick around and you'll go in the draw for those. First prize, $100 voucher from Seiko, a running performance test and 4 months of online coaching with me and my team at Coach. Second and third prizes are $100 Seiko voucher. We will also be offering a special promotion for those of you who want to do our advanced sweat test. You'll find out why that's useful as we get into this call, but we're doing a special promotion on that, which I'll share at the end as well. Right, let's have a quick look at this poll. So we've got 116 people on the call so far. And of those of you that have answered, 109, we've got 4% of you running the 5K, 4% running the 10K, 37% running the half marathon, 54% running the marathon, that's not surprising. It's good to see you half marathon and marathon runners taking this seriously. If you stuff up your execution in a 5K, you're only going to hurt for a few minutes and then the thing's going to be over with. If you stuff it up in a marathon, you're going to be suffering for a wee while. So it's important that you take on board what I'm going to speak with you about tonight and what Riana's going to share and apply this, because that's the key here, right? It's all well and good to hear it, but you need to apply it. And it does take some practice. So practice one, Standard Chartered Singapore Marathon 2022. That's where you're going to apply this, yeah? Is this your first time racing the distance? 27% of you are saying yes, 73% are saying no. That's cool. And pacing strategies. What is your pacing strategy? 3% of you are planning to start a little quicker and bank some time. 46% of you are planning to run an even pace. 38% of you are planning to start slow and get faster. And 11% of you have no plan and just going to see how you feel and wing it. All right. I'm very happy to see that the bulk of you want to run an even pace. We'll get into why that's important in just a second. The final question was, do you have a fueling strategy mapped out for the race? And I'm very happy to report 57% of you say that, yes, you have a fueling strategy mapped out, which is cool. No, 43%. Of those 43%, I hope you guys will consider putting in place a fueling strategy after you hear us speak tonight. I'm going to turn the poll off now, and then we're going to get into a few stats. And I've got another monitor here with the stats and things on. So if I'm looking over here, that's what I am looking at. When we decided to do this call, I reached out to Ironman, who organized the event, and I asked them if I could get the 2019, which was the last time the mass participation race happened, results, so that we could slice them in Excel and get a sense for what strategies people were employing. Because there's three race strategies you can use. You can run a positive split, which is where you start fast and get slower as the race goes on. You can run a negative split, which is the opposite of that, where you start slower and gradually build your effort over the race distance. Or the third strategy is to run an even pace. And my experience, and I've been doing this a wee while now, a professional coach for 15 years, and I've watched a lot of these races in Singapore and around the world, is that most people don't deliver on their plan. And most people will run a positive split, meaning they run the second half slower than the first half. And I figured the numbers would be pretty interesting. I figured a large percentage of the race would be running in that way, and not by choice. I think as the poll just showed, right? Like, I think, where is it? 4% of you on the call said you want to run fast at a bank time at the start, right? So if that's a fair representation of the people that run the race, it's pretty safe to say that you guys are starting too fast and blowing up. And that was what I figured. So I reached out to Ironman. They gave me the results. I am terrible in Excel. So fortunately for me, Riana, who you'll meet shortly, is an engineer and she loves Excel. And she spent some time kindly slicing and dicing the race results. Now, I'm only going to share the marathon because that was the only one where we had a halfway split, Matt. And so we could get like a half marathon time versus a marathon time, because that's quite telling. And I think execution is important in all distances from 400 meters up, but it's particularly important the longer you go. And so here are some stats from the 2019 marathon. 9,553 marathon runners finished the marathon having run over all the mats. There was 10,000 something that had some mats missing, so we discarded those people, and we only kept the people that ran over every single mat, okay? Of the 9,553 runners who finished the marathon, 9,236 ran a positive split, meaning that they ran the second half slower than the first half. And we define this by being at least 5 minutes slower than the first half, okay? 9,236 out of 9,553. It's a very large percentage, right? 58 runners ran an even split, All right, that's how Eliud Kipchoge runs. He runs an even split. And we define an even split for the purpose of this analysis as plus or minus 5 minutes of your half marathon time. So it's not really very even. It's still quite a bit slower either side. So only 58 runners. 259 runners ran a negative split, meaning they ran... Oh, sorry, I got that backwards. 58 ran a negative split, meaning they ran with... Where are we? Hang on. Can't read my writing. 259 ran an even split, meaning they ran within 5 minutes of their first half. 58 ran a negative split, meaning they ran 5 minutes or more faster than their first half. Okay, sorry for the confusion there. What's crazy though is of those 9,236 runners who ran a positive split, the average positive split was 39.6 minutes slower in the second half marathon. Just let that sit for a second. 39.6 minutes slower in the second half marathon. That is a lot of time. And that proves to me that so many runners left a tremendous amount of fitness on the race course, meaning that they should have been able to run dramatically better had they run with a better race execution. Of the people that ran the negative split, so the 58 runners who ran the negative split, they ran the second half on average 12.9 minutes faster than the second half. So that's still a lot, but that's a significantly better option than the positive split that the 9,000 plus people ran. And so I just wanted to plant this seed up front to illustrate how important execution is. And execution is within your control. The challenge I think you have, and that many athletes have, and that my coach always used to say to me, is we confuse ability with ambition, right? We may want to run a 4 hour marathon, for example, but what happens if we have 4 hour 10 fitness, right? 4 hours in that case is impossible. And if we try to start at 4 hour pace, we are going to run 4 hours 50 based on the stats that I just shared, right? I would far rather you ran 4 hours 10 than 4 hours 50. That's a far more satisfying experience and you're going to recover from it better, right? So this is the goal of race execution. With that in mind, Riana, do you want to show yourself and say hello to everybody?
Hi.
There you are. How are you doing?
Good. You?
Good. Do you want to give everyone a quick background about you, share your running journey, and tell them a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Hi, everyone. My name is Riana. I'm one of Ben's trainees, I guess. I've been training with Coach for 5 years now, a little over 5 years. I am so not athletically gifted. I just like running, but I do want to get better all the time, right? Who doesn't want to get better? So I've had quite a journey with running. Like Ben said, I've blown up quite a bit. I've had some ridiculous goals for myself and ending up blowing up. And I never knew what caused that. And I think I always, my problem all the time was the cramping and just kind of lost it at about 25 kilometers and beyond. So yeah, I think after a few tries, finally got it. And I am happy to finally got that before I got my 6-star. So I got my 6-star last year. And I think I can figure out how to do the even split thing.
Absolutely, you have. And you've been very much a work in progress because when I met you, you were not executing very well. And to prove that, we have quickly pulled together her 2017 Boston result, which I'll just quickly share here.
Berlin.
Berlin, yes, Berlin, sorry. And you can see here, she went through the half marathon in 2:22 and finished in 5:04. So you can do the math on that. She's running significantly slower in the second half. And again, like, that's important because you're leaving fitness on the table. Your goal in a race is to run at an even pace, meaning your first K and your last K are as close together as possible. You want to have minimal deviation. And the proof in that is by looking at Eliud Kipchoge. A ton of money, an absolute millions of dollars have gone into researching how to run a sub 2 hour marathon. And he was able to do that, obviously not under race conditions, but it was impressive nonetheless. And so much science and money went into to making that happen. And what all the science showed was that running an even pace, a dead even pace, was the fastest way to run. And if you look at the majority of his marathons, he has a very small deviation in pace, often just 10 seconds between his fastest kilometer and his slowest kilometer. My guess, if you looked at your results, is you might see something a little bit different. It was interesting just watching him run the Berlin Marathon this year. It was the most aggressive I've ever seen him run a race. And he was clearly trying to run a sub 2 hour marathon in a legal race. And he blew up. I say blew up, really, because it was done pretty gracefully. Unlike the rest of us who lose 40 minutes in the back end, he only managed to lose, I think it was about a minute and a half, which is incredibly impressive when you're running at 21 kilometers an hour and running with the output that he has. So, you know, we're never going to run that fast. That's a given. Maybe, you know, some of our kids could with the right training and the right environment and stuff like that. But us, let's face it, we're a bit older. We do this for fun. And it's unlikely we're going to run that quick. But there's no reason anyone on this call can't run an even pace. You may have to do some practice. You certainly have to test it in training. You need to know your training zone so you know at what effort to run. But it's very much a skill that all of you can practice and get better at. And when you do that, even if you don't do anything to change your fitness, you are going to be dramatically better. And what's nice about this too is, you know, sometimes you don't hit a goal time. Sometimes, you know, there's just crowding on the race course. Sometimes, you know, there's a strong headwind or, you know, like it's an unseasonably hot or cold day. And that is obviously going to impact your time. You know, if you still run to the best of your ability with smart execution, even if you miss your goal time, you will feel satisfied with your effort because you will know you did everything to get the most out of your fitness. And fitness is what it is on race day. You know, hopefully you've prepared well for a few months and it's fantastic. That's what you want. But sometimes life happens, work gets in the way, you had to travel on business, now the borders are open. And in those situations, it is what it is. You're on the start line. Your goal is still to maximize the fitness that you do have to give you the best result that you can. That's satisfying. That's what you should all be aiming for. So we worked with Riana. Obviously, we've put a lot of structure into her training and tried to make the training side of things better. We've also spent a lot of time speaking with her about fueling. And she, in credit to her, has gone away, done a heck of a lot of work, and made a lot of mistakes as she's gone through this journey. And it's an iterative process. I shared with you her Berlin result from 2017. What year did you run London that we wrote the blog about, Riana?
2019,
yeah. So then let me share this with you as well. I then used her as an example in a blog that I wrote, nicely titled, How You Can Race Like Eliud Kipchoge or Javier Gomez. Javier Gomez is a fantastic triathlete that I used to race, for those of you that don't know who he is. And he, like Eliud, very controlled, very graceful athlete, and something to aspire to. So can you see the Eliud Kipchoge blog post?
Yep.
Cool. Yeah, so if I scroll down, you don't have to read it all. You'll see here, these are Riana's 5K splits. If you look at her pace, it's pretty consistent. It's certainly not awesome, but it's pretty good. You know, her half marathon split, 2:24, her finishing time 4:49. So just under 5 minutes. That's pretty good. And she's getting closer. What's really interesting to look at though too is what happened in the different halves. And these again have pulled from the results of the London Marathon. So in the first half of the race, she passed 711 people, but was passed by 4,102 runners. In the second half though, look at this. She passed 3,809 and was only passed by 183. And this is not, she didn't pass all these runners because she suddenly put in a surge and was, you know, galloping to the finish. She just didn't slow down. She just kept running the same pace. And she was able to pass so many people. So again, this is another race that illustrates the idea that runners are leaving so much fitness on the race course and they're not maximizing their potential. If you have 4 hour fitness, run 4 hours, right? Do not confuse ability with ambition, because your goal is to maximize fitness. There's always another race, and each race is a stepping stone to the next one, as is the training cycle between it. And you want to work to the fitness that you have. We're going to get to Riana's latest race because it's very impressive. Do you want to talk a little bit about your recent experience, Riana?
Yeah, I can, but I do think there's a lot of discipline, especially on the first few kilometers, right? I think the ones that's raced before, you know, you stand on the start line, the excitement comes in, and then especially if you're in a big race, you know, there's a lot of people cheering. There's probably a lot of people a lot faster than you are. And the adrenaline kind of just push you through, you know, and it feels easy. So you're going to end up getting too fast. But that's where the discipline comes in. That's where basically the dialing in comes in as well. Because I think during your training, if you have the correct training zones, you'll know that. And then I think then towards the later part of the training, that's when we start getting to like race pace runs, right? And that's basically where you know whether, you know, where you know what the pace you can sustain. And I bet you on that first few kilometers, you're going to look at that pace that you remembered. Let's say we're aiming for about 6:45. That's going to be like, oh my God, it's so slow. Like I could do so much faster. Like let's just do 6:15 for this race. I've done that, and that's when I blew up, basically. So your target pace needs to be there, but there's a long road to discovering that target pace as well, and just this discipline of holding that, basically.
Absolutely. But let's share your result from Berlin. Show off. This is your moment to shine. It's very impressive.
You have that, right? You're going to share?
Oh, yeah, I do too.
Okay.
Really, cool. It's getting late in the day. I'm a Kiwi, man. I'm in bed at 10 o'clock kind of guy. So when I'm awake and working and talking at this time, I'm not quite as quick as I was. So here's Riana's recent Berlin result from this year.
Yeah.
Look at these half marathon splits. 2:13:32. 2:13:39. That's pretty pro from an execution point of view. And as we shared, this didn't come about first go. It's been an iterative process. She's getting better each time she plays the game. And all of you will be the same. The challenge with race day is that it presents a unique set of circumstances as well, right, Riana, that you just kind of touched on. When we do a lot of our training, particularly those of you who are dedicated and training for the marathon and half marathon and running a lot, you're always running on heavy legs, right? Because you've been running often. You're also a little bit dehydrated, most probably. And when you get to race day, if you're training well, you're going to taper down. That's a very wise thing to do. And you're going to freshen up. So for the first time in months, probably, you're going to have fresh legs. You're going to feel like $1 million. At the same time, if you know what you're doing, you will come into the race well hydrated, You'll have your glycogen topped up, so you've got gas in the tank. And then you've got to get on the start line. And on the start line, you're accompanied by thousands of other people who clearly, as the stats earlier showed, don't really know what they're doing. And they're going to start too fast, which potentially, if you have an ego and a lack of self-control, is going to sucker you into starting too fast. And when you start too fast, you set off a chain reaction, right? You sweat more, so you lose more sodium. You are working at a higher output than you need to, so you're burning more glycogen and potentially less fat. You're accumulating more lactate. All of these things build up over time and eventually lead to a slowing in pace. And that's what you guys are seeing in the stats and in your results. So race execution is all about self-discipline, having a plan, and then just executing the plan. And you also, I'm seeing in the chat, a lot of you are talking about the heat and humidity here. That's absolutely a factor and it's critical. And we will sort of touch on that slightly soon. But in these kind of circumstances and in this environment, you need to be even more conservative, right? Because it is harder. You're never going to run as fast in this kind of climate as you are in a place like Berlin or London or New York, where it's cooler, or Gold Coast, as a lot of us go to here in Singapore. The conditions are just harder here, but we can't change that. That's out of our control. So we don't worry about the conditions. We just prepare for them, right? We do the training and we learn how to fuel right. And fueling, we'll talk about shortly, is critically important in this environment. And again, been doing this a long time. Most people are doing it incredibly wrong. And you don't have to. You guys can fix this and you can do it well, and it will totally change how you race, how you feel, and how you recover. So it's all very important. Riana, I think we've sort of highlighted the importance of execution. Now, and we've shared your results and showed them what normal people like you can do, right? With a little bit of self-control. And now let's get into basically how you execute a race, right? The two main things when we think about how to execute a race, pacing, which we've been talking about primarily here. Pacing is incredibly important because if you get that wrong, it also impacts fueling, right? Because like I just mentioned, if you start too fast, you sweat more, your volume of sweat is higher. And in that, you're losing sodium and other electrolytes. You're burning up glycogen and you have a very limited store of glycogen that you keep in your muscles and liver. And then that needs to be replaced if you want to keep your output up. And so that's where fueling comes in. So pacing and fueling are the two key things you need to be thinking about on race day. Obviously, there's other things like keeping your mind in the right place, running with good form, all of that kind of stuff, tactics, cutting the tangents of the course. There's a whole lot of things that go into really maximizing your performance. But the two primary things are pacing and fueling. So let's talk a little bit first on pacing. If it's not clear by now, your goal is to run an even pace, right? And you want to finish the race completely knackered, because you can just run an easy, even pace by running really easy, but that doesn't maximize your fitness either. You want to run maximum sustainable pace for the distance of the race that you're doing. Obviously, your pace and intensity are going to be higher in a 10K than they are in a marathon, but the goal is the same across the disciplines, across the distances. You want to be running as close to even as possible, right?
Ben, I think there's a lot of questions on the chat though. Like, and that was my question as well, right? Yeah, the key is to run that even pace, but, and obviously everyone's pace is different, but what is that pace? How do we arrive to that pace?
I'm gonna get to that very shortly. Oh. Don't worry, I'm watching the questions and we'll circle back on all the questions. Goal is to run an even pace, finish at the end incredibly tired. If you can do that, you've maximized your fitness, all right? If you hold pace even, what you're going to feel is that it gets harder over time and your heart rate is going to go up. And that happens because even if you run the same pace, let's say you're running 5 minute pace, right? 5 minute pace at kilometer 2 feels a lot easier because the stress is a lot lower at kilometer 2. Your muscles aren't as damaged, you haven't burned up your glycogen, you're not as dehydrated. versus kilometer 40, where you've done all those things, the stress is greater. And so heart rate is reflecting that stress with it being high. But that's what you can anticipate. Even pace, increase in heart rate, increase in effort to sustain the pace as time passes, right? Heart rate will also often be high on race day, especially in the early stages due to adrenaline. So again, you need to factor that in when you're prepping your strategy as well. Now, in regards to figuring out your pace, there's a few things that you need to think about. The first thing is, and we spoke about this in the first call here in the series, is having training zones and knowing your intensities is critically important, right? You need to know where your aerobic threshold is, where your anaerobic threshold is, and what your training zones are, so that you can be precise in your training and execution of your training, because you also need to execute that well. But if you know those numbers, you can then start to apply them into racing. And so for the athletes we coach, we use five zones: easy, steady, moderately hard, hard, very hard. Those are the perceived exertions, right? Easy should feel easy, hard should feel hard. We tag those to pace zones and to heart rate zones. And those pace zones and heart rate zones correlate with markers of metabolic activity, like VO2 max, like fuel utilization, like lactate, for example, right? Essentially, the shorter the race, the higher the intensity you can run at. For a 10K, most people are going to run at a mid, moderately hard to mid hard pace. Again, if you're new, you're going to be mid mod hard. If you're really quite elite, you're going to be higher up mid hard pace. But here's the thing, you need to know what your hard pace is, and that's where testing comes in. So I'm a big fan of lactate testing. It's why we run a lab here in Singapore. But you don't have to come to the lab. You can do something called a functional threshold pace test that is a field test on your own. There's a link on our blog that shares the details of that. I suggest you check it out and potentially run one before the race if you want to get a sense for this. But you're going to run a 10K mid-mod hard to mid-hard pace zone. For a half marathon, you're going to run high steady to low-mod hard pace. And for a marathon, you're going to run a mid-steady pace. So for example, if your steady pace zone was, say, 505 to 620, you're going to run it somewhere in the region of 520 to 550, right? And again, this is a ballpark. You then test that in training, particularly in the final weeks leading in, where you're doing some race-based stuff, not in your long run, by the way, people, because if you're doing race pace in the long run, you're essentially doing the race and you're going to burn all your matches in training. Never do race pace stuff in the long run. You do that in other runs to test it. But that is how you get a sense for what you're doing. Another great thing you can do to further dial in your race pace is to do secondary races. So for a lot of the people on our team, I advised them to run the Marina Bay run that was happening recently, I think 29th of October. You know, if you're running the half marathon, I recommended doing the 10K. If you're running the marathon, I recommended doing the half marathon. And then if you do that in race conditions and you run it hard, just like you plan to do, well, A, you get a chance to practice this even pacing and your fueling and all these things under race environment, which is very important. But then B, you get a result with real world feedback. You see what your average heart rate is, you see what your average pace is, and then you can compare that with the training that you've been doing, and it starts to give you feedback. You can also plug it into a race conversion calculator. I like this one here, where you just plug in, say you ran 10K, for example, 10K in 40 minutes, and you're going to run a half marathon. And it tells you if you run a 40-minute 10K, there's a high chance you're going to run around a 1:28 half marathon. And then you take that time, you work out what that is per kilometer. You then compare that with your zones to see if it's reasonable, because again, you don't want to confuse ability with ambition. And these are just formulas that are guessing, educated guess, but a guess nonetheless. And then you can further refine it, and then you test that in training. So that's the process. And like we keep talking about, it's an iterative process. And then you do your race and then you get the real feedback and then you take that into your next race and you keep building on it. And the more you do it, the better you get at this, as Riana hopefully has illustrated in the call tonight. She's just been chipping away, getting better and better at the process. And I used to be good at it. I'm not so good at it anymore because I don't race often enough. And again, it's something that you get good at when you practice it and you lose when you don't. And so I just can't stress how important nailing your pacing is and actually understanding what you need to do and having the self-discipline to do it. Now, that's pacing. Let's talk about fueling, because particularly in this climate, fueling is critical. I mean, it's important in any climate if you want to maximize performance. You need gas in the tank. If you don't put gas in the tank, you will get slower over time. And again, fueling is far more important for a half marathon and a marathon than it is for a 5K and a 10K. But you want to fuel any distance properly or appropriately so that you maximize your performance on the day, but also recover from it quickly afterwards. So then again, you can get straight back into the next training cycle and keep building on things, because that's the goal. You just want to keep iterating and getting better and better as you go. So let's talk a little bit about how to fuel. Fueling is made up of two areas. Well, this is how I think about it anyway, two areas, right? Hydration and energy. Hydration is addressing volume. So how much sweat you lose, your sweat rate. We all have a different sweat rate genetically. Some of us sweat buckets, some of us sweat very little, and all of us will have a different sweat rate based on the climate. So in Singapore, we're going to sweat a lot more because it's so hot and humid than we are in Gold Coast, for example, where it's cooler. But just because we sweat a lot or sweat a little doesn't tell us anything about what our sweat is made up of. And that's where sodium loss comes in, because sodium is the primary electrolyte we need to replace when we're fueling these races. And we each lose a very different amount. I personally lose 1,259 milligrams per liter of sweat, which is considered pretty high. And I wish I'd known that when I was racing pro, because it would have saved me from a lot of cramps that I used to get and I didn't know why. So when you know your numbers, you can then formulate a plan. So hydration is made up of volume, and so sweat rate and sodium loss. You need to address both. The best way to address volume is to drink, right? You replace what you're sweating out with water. You can measure your sweat rate and get very nitty gritty. In my experience, I think the best way to do volume is just to drink to thirst. It's a very intuitive way to do it. And for me and for the athletes I coach, usually I recommend just doing that via water, right? You just water at the aid stations, every aid station, throwing some in your mouth. And, you know, as a minimum sort of probably in this climate, around 500 mils an hour. At a maximum, most people struggle to tolerate sort of more than 700, 750 mils per hour. It just seems to bounce around in your tummy. But again, everyone is different and some people can tolerate more. And if that's you, great. But that's a rough guideline. Sodium is something that people really underestimate, particularly in Singapore. I've been coaching a long time. We have our lab, we do a lot of testing, and people keep coming in and saying that they were suffering from cramps. Keep getting cramps. So I thought, okay, there's got to be a solution to this cramp thing. And so I started looking around, figuring out, you know, what was the cause of cramp and how could we help people beat cramp. And essentially, the two primary reasons people cramp is because of muscle fatigue. And again, you know, that ties back to starting too fast. If you start too fast, you fatigue your muscles and that can cause cramp. Or if you underprepare and you don't train enough, you don't have the muscular endurance and strength, that can cause cramp. But in this weather, because I know the people on our program are training well, and they're still cramping, it's primarily sodium, lack of sodium. And so I went in search of a test that we could use to measure sodium loss. And we found one. There's a great company in the UK, founded by a guy called Andy, who has a similar background to me. He's a former professional triathlete, although he did long course triathlon. And he basically went out to solve his own problem. He is a guy who was just cramping in all his races, and it was taking a lot of the fun out of his job, obviously causing him to underperform. And he went out and basically solved his own problem. But what I like about Andy is, because he's been such a high performance athlete, he comes at this with an athlete's mindset. He creates great products, and they have some great services. So we started to bring in his sweat test. We do sweat testing. And as I mentioned, we'll be doing a special rate for the sweat test, which I'll share in the chat now. But what we know, because they have sweat test centers like ours all over the world, and so they get a lot of information. And what I can tell you is that the average person loses 950 milligrams per liter of sodium, which is a lot. Like if you're looking at salt pills like this, there's 250 milligrams of sodium in each capsule. So you're essentially looking at a few of those per hour, if you're average, to replace a one for one. Now, you don't have to replace a one for one. Some dehydration is okay. But, you know, if you're average, you probably want to be going for a couple per hour. And that's significantly more than you get from most sports drinks. And it's incredibly important. It's been a massive game changer for our athletes once we started to introduce the right amount of sodium. So you need to take water for volume or sweat lost, and sodium to replace the electrolytes. And that's going to help minimize your chances of cramp while keeping you hydrated, because sodium helps you retain water. And that's very important. It helps you stay hydrated. The second side of this fueling equation is energy. And energy you can take through food or through sports drinks or through lollies, you know, gummies. But in my opinion, especially in marathons and things like that, the easiest way logistically are gels. Most people's stomach gels pretty well. They go into the bloodstream very quickly. They're very effective. And that's what you should be aiming for. As a rough guideline, you're aiming for about 1 gram per kilo of body weight. So I'm 70 kilos, so I'll be aiming for around 70 grams of carbohydrates per hour, which is a couple of gels per hour. Breaking it down by distance, here's a few recommendations. Let's do 10K first. 10K is short, so there's not a lot of need for energy. You have enough energy stored in your muscles and liver to see most of you through, at least those of you who run under an hour. So you drink water at aid stations. If you're running faster than an hour, no need for any external energy. And if you're running longer than an hour, you could consider taking one gel per hour, right? So it's pretty straightforward. For a half marathon, water at aid stations to thirst, you need to take in electrolytes, so sodium. So you can do that with salt pills. There's a bunch of different brands. Again, we like the precision hydration stuff, but you can get them from lots of different places. Or you could do like a sugar-free electrolyte drink where you're not getting energy from that drink, but you can use it for volume in place of water, and it's coming with sodium. So that's another good way to do it. Obviously, if you do that, you will need to carry your own fuel, because I don't think they have that on course. And then for those of you running under 2 hours for the half, you'll be aiming for around 30 grams of carbs per hour, which is a gel per hour. For those of you running 2 to 3 hours, you're looking at 30 to 60 grams of carbs, so essentially a couple of gels per hour. For the marathoners, same advice here, right? Water at the aid stations to thirst, or a sugar-free electrolyte to address volume, sodium via electrolyte tabs or sodium pills. If you're running under 4 hours, 60 to 90 grams per hour, so 2 to 3 gels as a guideline. And if you're running over 4 hours, 30 to 60 grams of carbs per hour as a guideline, which is 1 to 2 gels per hour. again, you need to test this. Do not try this on race day without experimenting with it, because it can cause bloating, it can cause nausea, it can cause really poor performance if you're not used to it. So that's the caveat. You still have a few weeks, practice this. All right, those are some pretty solid guidelines. I will be posting a blog in the next couple of weeks with all this laid out as well, so you can check it then, at least for race day. But try and keep in mind what I've shared here so that you can practice it, because it's very important. Right, I'm mindful of the time, so we're going to start to wrap this up soon, and I'll have a look at the questions. A couple of other things you want to consider on race day to maximize your performance: form, right? If you look at people in the first couple of K of a marathon, they look lovely. They're up high, they're running tall. You know, there's some bounce in this shape. You see them 30K later, they're hunched over, the head's down, they're groveling along. You have to be conscious of your form, because it's something you can control, right? And it can help keep your pace up, because that's the goal of running a marathon. You just don't want to slow down. Form is largely developed through training. Drills are fantastic. You should all be doing running drills if you're not. But it also comes through conscious effort, and you need to think about it. I use the chin as an anchor. I always want my chin parallel to the ground. If my chin is parallel to the ground, odds are it's over my shoulders. I want my shoulders back and relaxed. Arms, I want it about 90 degrees. So when you pull them back, they look like someone's getting a bow and pulling them back. You want to have a nice forward lean from your ankles, and that's key. You want to be tall. You don't want to be bent at the waist. You want to be nice and tall, but with a very subtle 5 to 10 degree lean. And what that does is that helps you carry your, basically, you're not fighting against gravity. Your weight is going naturally over your hips. And so you're not having to pick yourself up to carry it. It's just flowing. You get the momentum working with you rather than against you. And then you want to be coming down under your center of gravity when your foot hits the ground. Heel strike or midfoot ideally better, but doesn't overly matter so long as you are under your center of mass. And then as you get tired, particularly we're going to go up over Shears Bridge. This is where, you know, the arm carriage is great. If you can bring your arm swing up and increase the cadence of the arms, the legs will always follow. And so when your legs are very tired at that 38K point, when you're running up that hill, bring the arms in, and that will just help get you up over the hill and send you down the other side. So that's important. Mindset is important when you're running too. It's very easy to get suckered into a negative mindset, especially if you start too fast and everyone starts passing you afterwards, because that's very deflating. You don't have to be positive. Let's face it, running these races is damn tough, and you can't think it's all sunshine and unicorns and rainbows. Like that's not how it is. It's tough. We picked a hard sport. But the goal is neutral thinking. You don't want to be thinking about how terrible you're doing and how much you suck and how much it hurts. That's counterproductive. And so you need to trick your brain into like a neutral mindset. And you do that by thinking about your process, right? Looking at your pace, making sure you're on time and getting all your nutrition in, thinking about your form, constantly asking yourself questions, because the mind can only think about one thing at a time. And if you're thinking about stuff, you're not thinking about how much this sucks or how terrible you're doing and all of that. So you can trick your mind into it. And one of the best things I learned, a tool I was given by my mental conditioner back when I was racing, was something called body checks. And, you know, you're running a marathon, you get a little blister on your little toe, and that's not enough to derail your race, right? It doesn't affect your ability to run the pace you're running, but it blimmin' hurts. And it sucks all your energy from where it should be down to your toe. And you think, oh my God, it hurts. And you start getting in this little negative spiral about how much your foot hurts and how much you suck and how far you still got to go. And that's a big problem. In situations like that, body checks is a great tool that you can use to trick your mind into a neutral state. And so, for example, using the little toe blister, you can go up top, and so you go the opposite direction. Okay, how's my right ear feel? Yeah, my right ear feels fine. How's my left ear feel? Yeah, that's cool. How's my nose? How's my left nostril? How's my nose? It seems pointless. But what it's doing is it's tricking your mind into thinking about something neutral. And it works remarkably well when you practice it. It's a bit like meditation. in the sense that, you know, you're concentrating your focus on a specific object like the breath or in the case of meditation. But it really does help a lot. And so that is a great tool that you can use as well. So pacing, fueling, form, mindset. Those are the things that you want to be thinking about. All right, Riana, do you want to add anything from your experience about fueling, hydration, anything?
I think for fueling and hydration, I pretty much got it down to a science. And you know me, when something works, I don't change it. But then there's a twist also, right? Like sometimes when it works on this race, it doesn't quite work on the other race, you know? So I think we need to be agile also with our plan. We can have a plan, but kind of adjust it towards the race as well. Because I had a very exact plan. And in Berlin, one of my gel towards the end just didn't sit well. You know, so, you know, I replaced that with whatever it is that they had at the aid table, and that helped a lot. I think I want to touch on the mindset as well. I'm horrible with myself on races. You know, it's like, you're not doing well enough, blah, 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 you know, and it's like, you know, I was actually really surprised to see my splits, that it was super nice, because, you know, every now and then I would see the kilometer split and it was off by like 5 seconds. And I'm like, oh my God, you know, I can't show off this thing to Ben anymore. You know, all that things going on in my head. But I think I use the body check thing that you say, that you taught me, and I used it with my running buddy as well when she was running a pool. So that really worked well. But I think my newest revelation that works really, really well is that forward-leaning tilting thing that you taught me. I think that contributed to at least 10 seconds per kilometer, I want to say. So I saw there's somebody asking, seemed to have a trouble keeping that. So, you know, hopefully we can give him a tip. So, because if I found that really useful, I think he could do.
Yeah, I mean, the forward lean thing's interesting, because if you watch, again, using Eliud Kipchoge as the poster child, I mean, his form is incredible. And if you watch the guy run, he's got a nice forward lean like this from his ankles. He's not bent at the waist running along like this. He's just subtly forward, and that momentum is carrying him over his hips, and he's able to maintain a high pace. Now, that's a combination of him being very strong through the posterior chain. He does a lot of strength training. He does a lot of run training. He's very well conditioned. And so the more conditioned you are from a muscular point of view, the better you're going to be able to hold form. That's why training is so incredibly important. But it also takes conscious effort. It's very easy just to switch off and to all of a sudden notice you dropped your chin and you're bending at the waist and your stride length is shorter. You know, these things are trainable. And again, it comes just back to the self-awareness and practicing and getting good at recognizing when you're doing it and when you're not, because you will start to notice it feels much easier when you do it.
Right. But then eventually the start is going to feel really weird, right? It feels like you're about to fall. And I think the one thing that you told me also is like, whenever you're stopped at the light, you know, when you restart, you kind of like fall into your run, and that's just how you start and continuing it that way.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I do. And if I just tilt my screen a little bit so you can sort of see what I'm talking about. So like when I start a run, I just get in the habit of falling into the run, because there I'm setting the intention of what posture I want to run in. And it's just a good way to program the muscle memory and the mind. And then it's a matter of just conscious thought over time. So that's a good point. Right, we've got to wrap up shortly. So let's dive into the comments and quickly scan through those and see if there's anything there that I've missed. Hopefully what we've spoken about is useful, and hopefully you will apply it and use the self-discipline that I know you have to maximize your fitness, because that's all you can ask for. You want to maximize the fitness that you have. And trust me, you'll feel very satisfied with yourself if you can do that. Let me have a look. How do we set a marathon race time goal for training? First step is understanding your training zones. So either come and see us in the lab, do a lactate test to determine that, or run an FTPA test, which you can find on our blog, coach.fitness/blog, and then just search FTPA, you'll find it there. Once you know your zones, then I've already shared roughly where you run for each distance in the zones, and then you test that in training. If you can do a secondary race, you do a secondary race, you belt that, you take it, you put it into a race calculator, like I shared as well. And I'll just drop this in the chat so that you guys can reference it if you want to. And again, that's not foolproof. You then check that in training and continue to iterate. Please provide pointers on how to deal with heat and humidity here. I've run in temperate climates and it was very different. Yeah, it's significantly harder to run in this environment, and controlling your ambition in this environment is incredibly important, and your ego. You have to be more conservative in these kind of conditions, and you have to pay particular attention to the volume of fluids you're consuming and the replacement of electrolytes. Very, very important. And most runners in Singapore particularly are not getting anywhere near enough sodium. And so that's probably the best thing you can do. That's the easiest fix. You can technically OD on salt, but it's pretty hard to do. I wouldn't think you're going to be able to do it in a race, that's for sure. But use that 950 milligrams per liter as a guideline. Again, you don't have to replace all that. Aim for 700, something like that. Good enough. Also, try and keep cool as possible until you start, right? You want to keep your body temperature down as low as possible. So self-preservation. And obviously too, this is another key thing. You know, we're starting very early. So, most of us are going to finish probably as the sun's coming up or before the sun's really high. But if you do think you're going to be running when it's really hot and the sun's going to be up, do some of your training in the sun so that you know how it feels. The body is very clever. It will respond to what you show it, and it will adapt pretty quick. So that's my advice for that. How high is usually the temperature? Too high. I don't know, 30 degrees?
28, 27. 28,
30, it will probably vary somewhere in there, yeah.
But the humidity is going to be there.
And the humidity is a bigger challenge, at least in my experience. I've raced in some very hot, dry climates. And while it's always painful to race in the heat, heat is not draining in the same way that humidity is. So humidity is tough. In Singapore, we got heat and humidity. So it's definitely hard. Could you share the recording later? Yep, they'll be putting it up on YouTube and sharing on Facebook as well, I believe, in the next few days. So please look out for that and share it with your friends as well if they couldn't make it tonight. How to overcome bunion feet to complete a marathon. I've completed many full marathons before, but this year having new bunion issue. I've never had that experience, as I'm not a person with bunions, but what comes to mind is shoe selection and lacing methods. So, you know, most of us tie the traditional crisscross laces. There's a ton of different lacing methods you can use. If I do a quick search on our blog here, we worked with Tim Maiden at the Foot Practice, who's a wonderful podiatrist here in Singapore, to put together some animations that demonstrate some different lacing methods. So I'll put this in the chat here as well. And there's one on here that is for bunions, one for blisters, one for black toenails, all that fun stuff that we get as runners. So you could certainly start with that and see if it helps. Hopefully it will. Now, let me jump back. Where was I? Which training zone is race pace in? It depends on the distance you're running. The shorter it is, the higher the intensity you can run at. We mentioned that earlier in the call. It's 3 weeks away from race day. Will lactate metabolic tests still help me, or just go along with 4 months of training? Yeah, I mean, it's better to do it early so that you can practice all this in training, but I still think doing a lactate test now is incredibly useful, because what it's going to do is it's going to help you align your expectation. Because if you have these grand goals that you want to achieve, and then we say, hey, hang on, you're not very efficient, your zones don't match, you know, your race pace, well, then we're going to encourage you to scale that back. And interestingly, I had a call a bit like this with one of the guys that I work with, and he went to Berlin, and he wanted to run a 4-hour marathon. I got on a call with him a few days before the race. He's like, I want to run, you know, my goal is to run four hour pace. I said, hang on a second. And I looked at his lactate result. I'm like, you can't run that fast, mate. You're going to run somewhere between 4.8 and 4.12 most probably. And he's like, no, I think I can. I said, it's your call. You can try, but I think you'll end up running 4.30 or slower. And in credit, he listened to me and he ran 4.09. So he maximized his fitness, and it was really cool to see. So I definitely think doing a test is worthwhile, because it's going to give you a sense of where you're at, and it's going to help you determine a potential pacing strategy. And again, it may not be 100% correct, because like I said, you do need to practice this stuff, but it's certainly going to give you a lot more insight than going into the race blind and trying to guess that. So I would encourage you to do it. Yeah. What are your thoughts on going for a cardio practice session before race day? I'm assuming you mean chiropractor. I never used to do that personally. Massage, I was more of a fan of, and I'd probably encourage that over seeing a chiropractor. But if you have a bad back and you feel like you'd benefit from a chiropractor, absolutely. How long should we warm up for a long distance race? Which muscle groups to target and warm up? Yeah, I mean, again, the shorter the race, the more sort of dedicated you warm up you probably do. You know, when I used to do my 5 and 10K races, like I'd warm up for longer than the actual races. For a marathon, you don't want to warm up too much, especially at our level, we're not elite. So you're better off to do a bit of a dynamic warm up, some leg swings, things to open up the hips, some, you know, walking lunges potentially. There's, again, go on our blog, search warm up. There's some videos on there that will demonstrate some exercises. But I think, if it was me and I was going to run the marathon, I'd go and run 5 to 10 minutes just to get the blood flowing. I would do a couple of accelerations where you just gradually get faster up to a relaxed, fast pace. Jog back, do that again. I do that 2 to 4 times, depending on how I'm feeling. They're just really good for sparking the legs and kind of getting my mind in the right place. And then I'd go get on the start line with everyone else. And you're relatively limited by what you can do in there, unless you're elite and can run off the front and do your accelerations out there. But when I'm on there, I'm just standing there shaking my legs out. If I have space, do a few leg swings, just trying to open up my hips a little bit. And to just keep blood flowing in the legs, like just keeping the blood moving so that when you start, you warm into it. But, you know, a marathon's a long way. You can kind of ease into it. And it's not a high intensity event, right? Like you're running in zone 2 probably. So it's not like you're risking pulling a muscle or something because it's explosive. What else have we got here? How to control the heart rate in the heat. Hydration is the best way to do that, and self-control in your pacing. So as I mentioned earlier, heart rate's going to climb over time, no matter what. That happens because core temperature is increasing and because fatigue is going up and heart rate's just reflecting the stress. But you can control heart rate to a point with hydration. Obviously, if you're letting yourself get really dehydrated and you're losing all the sodium and things, body's under stress, heart rate's going to go up. So anything you can do to minimize stress is going to keep heart rate lower. Aerobic conditioning and training is also going to make your heart stronger and help with that as well. You'll have less decoupling as you run. So training at the right intensities, again, I've been harping on this, but it's incredibly important, is the way to go. I always experience a toe blood clot after a half marathon. So I'm assuming you mean the black toenail. Again, check out the lacing methods. Look at the sizing of your shoes. Your feet expand in heat. So sometimes it's worthwhile going a half size or a whole size up in your shoes when you race in this kind of weather. That's something you can consider. How many hours should our meal be before race time? So again, practice this in training. It's important. For me, I usually try to eat 3 hours before, or I would start eating 3 hours before, try to be finished before 2.5 hours. When a race starts at 4:30, for me, that looked like waking up very early, doing the food, then getting back into bed and trying to sleep. Most of the time I couldn't, but I'm just trying to stay there and doze or stay calm. But the reason I want to eat that early is because you get it in your system, you give it time to go where it needs to go and to leave the body, because the last thing you want it to do is leave the body during the race. So I would say, yeah, minimum 2 hours. For me, it was usually 3 hours, but it depends a little bit on the time of day, what you've practiced, all of that kind of stuff. Let me see. Any advice about sleep slash rest before race day? Yeah, so night before the race, I wouldn't get too stressed about sleep. You know, it's very hard to get a good night's sleep for a race that starts at 4:30 in the morning. We're going to have adrenaline. We're going to be excited. We're going to have to wake up incredibly early. So, you know, try and get as much sleep as you can, but that sleep is less important. I think the sleeps leading in are incredibly important. And in that race week, you want to be aiming for as much as possible, but at least 8 hours. And you know, the longer you can string that together for, the better. Sleep is regenerative. It's how you repair and build strength. Like, your training doesn't make you better, it breaks you down. When you go to bed after having done your training, your body goes to work giving you the benefit of that session. So sleep is critical. I'm 63 years old and I have completed 10K run in 59 minutes. Is it a good speed? You need your ego stroked. Yeah, it's good. Did you do your best? That's the main thing, man. That's the main thing. Did you give your best effort? Did you prepare to the best of your ability? Did you execute the race to the best of your ability? If yes, freaking awesome. Absolutely great time. If no, do the work and you'll feel much better about it. And just on that note, you can get better. We've got a guy on our team who just turned 70 and he ran a 1:58 half marathon, which was his PB. So you can keep getting better and better and better. It's quite remarkable. Don't let age keep you down. It's a mindset, they tell me. Yeah, after running 32K, my speed slowed down considerably. Any tips to overcome this? Yeah, so Francis, you are essentially confusing ability and ambition, I would imagine. You probably started faster than you needed to. I would guess that's the primary cause. It could also be a fueling issue. You just didn't take in enough gas. And so you run out of gas and you slowed down. But I would say it's probably a pacing issue and you needed to start more conservatively. So what's the best secondary race distance for to try a race paced marathon? Half marathon is great as prep for a marathon in the last sort of four to six weeks. That's what I recommend, which is why I had a lot of our guys running the marina run on 31st of October. It's just good timing. For a marathon, what distance should we train up to for our longest run? I'm not a huge fan of distance. I don't think it overly matters. I prescribe all our training by time. The body doesn't know what a kilometer is. And, you know, what matters is time on your feet and steps, honestly. It's the steps that do the damage. Every time your foot slams the ground, you are putting shock through the joints, the muscles, the tendons, the ligaments, all of that stuff. And that's the damage. So, you know, I think we usually give out a long run anywhere between 2.5 to 2 hours 45, sometimes a bit longer. And some people cover 30K in that, others cover 21K in that. And we've had people running PBs off 20K long runs, which is on the very short end of stuff. And most people are usually doing longer than that, but it's more the time. And I always circle back to Eliud Kipchoge, and it's interesting this, like, based on what I've seen of his training, he does around a 2-hour 20 long run. And I look at that and go, that's a pretty short long run. He covers 40K because the guy's crazy fast. But it's the time that's important, right? Because, you know, he runs at a cadence of around 180 steps per minute. I'm sure there's a bunch of you on this call who run at 180 steps per minute. The difference in pace is the length of the stride. And so if you go and run 2 hours 20 minutes, but you only cover 18K, you've still taken the same amount of steps as the guy and done the same amount of damage as the guy. So you're getting the same training effect, essentially. That's the key. If you go and run, you know, the same 40K that he did, and it took you 4 or 5 hours, you're getting a lot more stress than he is. So I wouldn't get too hung up on the distance. I would look at running volume through frequency to time. That's what I encourage, meaning run as often as you can to a time, and that will build strength over time. Good evening. Are water stations available in the race route? Absolutely, yeah. And they're at a pretty high frequency as well here in Singapore. I believe there's water, there's 100 plus on course. I think there might be some gels and even some bananas and stuff. Again, that stuff is all in the race handbook, which is on the website, singaporemarathon.com, and you can check out all of that. Ben dishing out tough love, always. Yeah, you know, I want you guys to do your best. I want you to do your best, because this is the thing, you know, it's self-satisfaction that you guys should be chasing, right? And you get that by giving your best effort, regardless of the times. Obviously, we want to run fast times, like, sure, but it's the effort that makes everything possible. Not going to lie, I have many friends who do long, slow distance running near a race pace. Yeah, I mean, that's a fundamental mistake. And, you know, they'll be very fit, but I wouldn't, that's not a high performance formula. If I'm taking Tailwind for the race, can I do away with gel since it comes with calories? Yeah, potentially. You need to obviously run the numbers and make sure that you're getting roughly what I was prescribing earlier. But yeah, absolutely. My longest run was 26K in 3 hours, 30 minutes. Is that enough for a full marathon? Yes, I believe it is. So long as you've been doing other runs as well, right? Like again, volume through frequency. Minimum frequency for a marathon, four runs per week, in my opinion. It's a good frequency. You can obviously finish a marathon on a lot less than that, but 4 runs per week is a good frequency where you can comfortably finish the marathon, have a good experience, and recover from it relatively quickly afterwards. Long runs above 3 hours 30 have no extra benefit. Yeah, I mean, they have little extra benefit because it's a subject for another call. It's a long answer, but yeah, I tend to agree. After keeping a constant comfortable pace for the full marathon, should I do a negative split towards the end? Will that be too ambitious? I mean, the goal is to run as close to even as possible, right? If you're worried, it's always better to be conservative and gradually build your effort and get faster, right? If you start too fast, there's only one way you're going to go, and that's not the way you want to go. You know, if you start too conservatively and you get 30K in and you're feeling like $1 million, you can gradually build your effort over the next 12K until you're running flat out down the finish line. And that's going to give you a far better outcome than starting fast, blowing up, and running 40 minutes slower for the second half, like we discussed earlier in the call. How many days after a marathon race should I do a recovery run, and how long should it be? I typically recommend taking at least 10 days off running, a few days off overall. Maybe after 4 or 5 days, you can get on a bike or do some swimming or something very low impact, but 10 days, no running, and then, 20, 30 minutes easy. See how you feel, gradually just build it up. No intensity for a little while, that's for sure. Just keep it zone one, zone two. A marathon really hits you around, especially a road marathon. You know, your muscles will feel better, like meaning your legs won't hurt after maybe a few days, but that doesn't mean you're fully recovered. And it takes a lot longer than that, usually a few weeks. So just be careful. All right. I think we've covered everything, folks. That's cool. Now let me bring back my notes so we can wrap this up. All right, so as I mentioned, we've got some prizes. Seiko is sponsoring some $100 vouchers. We at Coached are sponsoring some testing and some training programs. If you are lucky enough to have won that, Ironman are determining that. They will be in touch. And then for those of you that do win, particularly the person that wins the testing and training with us, I look forward to working with you, and I hope you'll get in touch pretty soon. With that, I want to thank you very much to Riana as well. I hope her experience was useful. I hope you'll take on board what we shared today on this call, because we can give you the best advice in the world. If you don't take it, it's not going to help. And we want it to help. We want you to have a great race. I will be at the race. I will be standing probably before Shears Bridge. And I'll be going, come on, because that's where it's hard. You guys are all going to be struggling. But get to that point with gas in the tank, because you run a smart race. Self-preservation in these long runs. If you want to really dial in your fueling strategy and to figure out exactly what you need to drink, we're doing a special promotion on our sweat test that I spoke about earlier. We're doing this from the Race Expo. Come along and test there. We're offering $60 off our sweat test. So it's a good saving. And this is a genetic number. It doesn't change. So once you've done it, you have it for life. You can apply it for life, and it's gonna give you a significant boost in performance. And we've seen this over and over again. So I encourage you to do that if you have the time and means to be able to do it. It's a great help. Hopefully this series has been helpful for you. We put a lot of thought into the subjects we wanted to talk about. And, we have a lot of experience working with runners of all abilities and triathletes as well. I mean, that's my primary background. But people just make such basic mistakes. And it's a real shame, because you don't have to, it just takes a little bit of practice, a little bit of planning, and you guys can do dramatically better than you thought was possible. And that gives me a lot of pleasure as a coach. And, people like Riana are a great example. They're a living example of what I'm advocating here. She puts in the work, she's diligent, doesn't take herself too seriously most of the time. She still enjoys the process. But she's getting some great results, and she's proving you can run like Eliud Kipchoge, even if you're going twice as slow, which is the case. And fair enough, the guy runs a marathon at 21K an hour. That's absolutely mind-boggling. So with
that,
you
are better in Excel than him.
Oh, you're absolutely better at Excel than me. So thank you for slicing those numbers. Wasn't that interesting? Just goes to show execution. Very, very important. Guys, I think we've covered it all. I'm going to be at the Race Expo at the Simply Active booth. We'll have our sweat testing down there. We will have, precision hydration stuff if you want to get hold of that before the race, or if you just want to come and have a chat and say hi, we'd love to speak to you. So come along, say hello. I'll be out on the race course as well, giving you guys a yell. And I wish you an absolutely fantastic race. on the 3rd or 4th of December, whenever you line up. But just let my voice, my annoying Kiwi accent, be in your mind, particularly in the early stages, reminding you to control your ego and to keep things under control so that you can really run a strong second half. With that, thanks so much for joining. I hope these talks have been helpful, and I look forward to seeing you soon, guys. Cheers.